Thank you very much, and good afternoon. It's a very challenging time. It's afternoon, and it's after lunch. And we are supposed to take a nap. But I'm asked to keep you all engaged. So it's very challenging. But I'm very grateful that we have a very, very intriguing topic for this panel. And I have three very high power thinkers to share with you their thoughts on the issue that is put on the screen here. It's interesting that this conference started with some game analogies here. This morning we talked about prisoner's dilemma, and then this one is new games in Asia Pacific. And also it's interesting that this morning, Deputy Secretary of Defense, Secretary Work, used a lot of game analogies. He talked about chess, he talked about poker, and he talked about just short of American football. Very interesting game analogies here. And my question to him certainly gets some response, but not completely. And for our panelists' information as well, because they missed his talk this morning, the Secretary was talking about an air-land battle 2.0, which is going to be different from air-sea battle 1.0. And he used a free play chess concept to execute that plan. And also to answer my question is that he thinks that this free play chess is going to defeat the Chinese gold analogy. Very, very powerful answer. I didn't have a chance to provide my rebuttal, and I just take this one without him here, which is unfair to him, is that the chess mindset, certainly he thinks, is more operational, and it's going to help us in dealing with the Chinese in the battlefield. My answer to that is that the goal analogy is equally operational. And when it comes to the operational field, it is equally brutal, okay? Even though on the appearance, it doesn't look like that. And also, the Secretary talked about machine beating chess. By the way, machine has not beaten Go yet. So that's a great challenge for that. Anyway. I think that we put these new games in Asia Pacific. You probably think about competitions, game type of competitions. And I think that's probably the right way to think about it. And from my perspective, these new games in Asia Pacific could be looked at in this way. At the top of it, it has to be the United States and China. And there's a lot of different new games to play between these two great powers. And I, among many other things, not to complicate my panelists, I just want to highlight one thing is that China is now appear to do some agenda setting things. And the United States is now responding to Chinese move. That is a great game changer behavior in Asia Pacific, where we used to lead China. We make initiative, and Chinese responded to us. And now that is changing. And then at a secondary level, it is China-Japan. And then third level, China and with all its neighbors. All those new games are somehow China-related. And I want to finally throw out Russia as a spoiler, as an intervening variable to complicate Asia-Pacific affairs. So that's the kind of my opening remark and throw it out, not to complicate the thought here, but to challenge my panelists to share their thoughts on the geostrategic dynamics in this region and the impact to our first principles of national defense. So without further ado, I'd like to go this order and then have them share their thoughts with you. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be in Carlisle and back at the Army War College. To extend the game metaphor, I'm fortunate that the Little League schedule permits me to be here with you today. What I thought I could do most usefully to kick this panel off was to set the stage by focusing on the connections between economics and security in Asia and in the ways they affect the strategic context and U.S. strategy toward the region. And I'll just start with the paradox that Asia really is unusual. You have countries that don't like or trust each other one bit that have become increasingly economically interdependent over the past 20 or 30 years. And that's really a phenomenon that theoretically it shouldn't happen. If you don't trust the other country, you shouldn't be trading and investing with them and becoming interdependent with them. But that is a phenomenon that does exist, and I will argue in my remarks that it really is going to shape the nature of strategy and strategic competition in the region. And I'll start by noting that today countries in Asia are looking to the U.S. increasingly as a security provider, both for our formal treaty allies and informal partners, but are also looking at China as a key market and hub for economic activity. And they don't want to have to choose between those two goals. Let me start by just talking, reviewing the U.S. security role in Asia. I mean, we got into this having basically defeated the Japanese in World War II and occupied the theater. And then, with the outbreak of the Korean War, we found ourselves having to intervene and be involved much more centrally in security in Asia. And that role has continued since then, both with our formal treaty allies, our involvement in the Vietnam War, but a real focus on stability and security in Asia and the U.S. role in the Cold War of defeating communism, in the post-Cold War era of providing stability. And not necessarily as the intended consequence of that, that U.S. role in our relations with our allies, the stability we provided and the market access, technology, and FDI, foreign direct investment that we provided, really gets a fair amount should get a fair amount of the credit for the Asian economic miracle that followed since then, first Japan, then South Korea, Singapore, Taiwan, other countries, and the regional economic integration we see today. So the U.S. started out thinking security, but a foundation, a result of that, was the economic integration we see in Asia. I think if you bring China in, it was outside this system. It was a communist, part of the communist bloc. It was seen as a threat. It was something to be isolated and curtail the flow of technology. But with the U.S.-China rapprochement, China gained access to the global economy, eventually to the U.S. market. And this was conceived as a way of cementing the strategic relationship between the U.S. and China against the Soviet Union. But the consequence has been to support Chinese economic growth. When they adopted market-oriented reforms, they started to be able to take advantage of this access. And the result has been 30 years of rapid economic growth. And that's not only transformed China domestically and transformed its power position, it's also transformed the regional economies as countries have taken advantage of cheap labor in China and now a manufacturing base to use investment to take advantage of that to export to the U.S., to the Europe, back to Asia, and into the China domestic market. So China has become integral to this regional economic integration, and it's now also, as it's become richer, has become very important as a domestic market in and of itself. And that's for commodities, that's for Australian iron ore, it's for Indonesian lumber, and it's for electronics and cars made throughout Asia. So you really have an economic integration here that originally flowed from security decisions. And now we're seeing the other side of that as China converts its economic power into military power and influence throughout the region. I won't go into detail, but they've been building a more capable military. And over the last decade, we've started to see more power projection pieces of that, whether you're talking about their conventional and nuclear missile force, whether you're talking about a navy that's increasingly active both within the South China Sea and East China Sea, and starting to be beyond that into the Indian Ocean and the Gulf of Aden. Now, that puts countries in the region in kind of a difficult situation because they're looking to the U.S. For security, they're looking to China for economics, and they have concerns about the impact of Chinese power. Part of that is, how is China going to use this increasingly capable and expeditionary military? Is that going to be a threat to their particular interests? I think a deeper concern is whether China is seeking regional dominance. And I think many countries in the region see China as seeking to return to a Sino-centric system where China is the one calling the shots and other countries in the region have to defer to Chinese wishes and interests. And they're not really eager to return to that kind of a world. And then finally, for many countries, they have territorial or border disputes with China, India with the land border, Taiwan, whose status is contested by China, and then the countries with maritime disputes in the East China Sea, Japan, and the South China Sea, Vietnam, Malaysia, Philippines, Brunei. So a number of concerns about how a stronger China will behave, and the fact that we've seen a more assertive China since 2009, including on maritime issues, is aggravating those concerns. And that's pulling countries in different ways. Just to give a couple examples, and I'll use U.S. treaty allies because I think that makes it the starkest. If you look at South Korea, they now export twice as much to China as they do to the United States. And that's a critical economic market for them. That's where they see their economic future. And it's also important as they look down the road toward Korean unification, because China is going to have at least a voice and maybe a veto in that. But they're also looking to the United States for security against an increasingly North Korea armed with nuclear weapons and an increasingly capable missile force. And so they want to balance both of these things, but they feel themselves caught in between those. And two recent manifestations in the news are the Asian Industrial Infrastructure Bank that China has just announced, and Korea has announced that it would join. That was something China wanted. And the dispute about whether to base the theater high altitude area defense system in South Korea, partly to protect, or mainly to protect against an increasing North Korea missile threat. But China worries that it might negate its deterrence and has leaned very heavily on South Korea not to pursue that system. So that shows a Korea that's caught in between the great powers. In Australia, this is also pretty stark. They export 8 times as much to China as they do to South Korea. And the recent economic boom in Australia has been fueled by iron ore and other exports to China. And that's also fueled a debate about how Australia should position itself. Should it lean more toward the United States, its treaty ally? They've been with us in almost every war we've fought. Cultural similarities, a common democratic viewpoint. Is that the direction they should go, or will the pocketbook draw them closer to China? And that's a tension that they're trying to deal with, and it manifests itself in funny ways. We've been doing research on Chinese military diplomacy, and in the course of doing that, we found that Australia was sending an awful lot of defense officials and generals to engage the PLA, partly, I think, to smooth over some of these tensions. And then finally, Japan, which is the country maybe most caught in the middle, China has bounced up and down between being its number one and number two economic partner, critically important to the Japanese economy. Yet at the same time, there's a very bitter history there, partly due to the Japanese invasion and aggression against China. And the Chinese don't forget that. That's part of their Chinese nationalism. And partly also due to the fact that we've never had a strong China and Japan at the same time. And in an Asia that tends to think in terms of hierarchy, to have an equal number one and number two relationship is something that's a little bit alien. In Europe, France and Germany proved able to work together, and that fostered economic integration. But China has not been willing to make that kind of place for Japan. And so I think countries in Asia are caught in between. They're trying to strengthen their ties with the United States. They're spending a little bit more on defense. They're also engaging with outside actors, such as encouraging Japan, India, the EU, and Russia to do more. But I think the key point is they're caught in the middle. So let me sketch briefly some of the implications of that. I think the first and most important is countries are going to be reluctant to clearly pick a side or cooperate in ways that are explicitly aimed against China. This is not going to be a black and white world where you say they're on our side and those guys are against China. Countries are going to have relations with both China and the United States, and they're going to regard both of those relationships as important and not want to pick sides. And in fact, I think the model for some countries is to use their ties with the United States to modulate those ties even as a way of limiting pressure from China. And I think Vietnam is the clearest example. You talk to Vietnamese diplomats, and they're very clear that the relationship with China is a very important one, and they cannot allow that to be a negative or hostile relationship. So yes, they're doing more in terms of security cooperation with the United States, but that's partly intended to limit Chinese pressure on them. And I think there's some implications of that, that you're not going to have an Asian NATO that's an anti-China alliance. And I think it'll be very difficult to get cooperation, security cooperation that's explicitly aimed against China. It's going to be a much more ambiguous set of relations, and that's got to affect how we do strategy. I think a second key takeaway is that China's also constrained by its economic interests. They're seeking to balance regional security and stability that let their economic growth continue while taking a more active role in making progress on territorial goals, including its maritime disputes. And some of the ways that plays out is how they've reached out to Washington to try to stabilize the U.S.-China relationship under their rubric of the new type of major country relationship, and the fact that they've pursued their territorial goals through limited means, trying not to use lethal military force. And yes, China's certainly more aggressive on territorial issues than they were from 97 to 2008, but the means they're using are a lot less aggressive than they used in the 1970s and 1980s. I think a third point to make, and I'm laying down some red meat for Patrick because he may disagree with some of these things, that the maritime and border disputes in the region are mostly not existential for any of the claimants involved. However, they are important for economic, domestic politics, and symbolic reasons. So it is clearly a source of increasing tension, but none of the countries involved has incentives to really have to fight because the costs of fighting would probably be more than the value of territories. Doesn't mean there can't be a conflict, but that's an important point that these are not existential issues. Fourth point, for the U.S., the China challenge really is multifaceted. There's a tendency to think about this mainly in military terms, and there is a military challenge as China's military modernization has made considerable progress. But there's also economic and diplomatic aspects of it that we really have to take into account. And if you ask me what is China's most important tool of power projection, I would say it's economics, because that's the tool that goes the furthest and wins the most friends in the region. And I think an implication of that for the U.S. is we can't think of our strategy or our security in narrow military terms. We have to recognize that the economic role is as important to our security as the military. And that means both getting the health of the U.S. economy right, because that's the foundation of our power, and second, it also means thinking about economic instruments and diplomacy as strategic tools. As Secretary Carter said in his recent speech, TPP really is a strategic issue, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, for the United States and Asia, because if we're not in the economic game in the region, we're going to be really hampered in what we can do in strategic and security concerns. And so I'll wrap up with a final point. Within this more ambiguous strategic environment that I've described, where economics and security cut in different ways, where you're not so sure that you have permanent friends, that the countries you're dealing with have good relations with Washington and with Beijing, I think it becomes even more important to have better policy coordination and integration of our economic, diplomatic, and military instruments of power. This was an explicit goal of the U.S. rebalance of Asia to integrate those instruments more effectively, but as I think the recent issue of the Asian Industrial Investment Bank has shown, in practice it's turning out to be a real challenge to get all those instruments operating effectively and in sync and get that policy coordinated and effective. So let me stop there.
Thank you very much. By the way, I forgot to introduce our panelists, Dr. Saunders from the National Defense University. And we have...
If you don't like it, I'm Patrick Cronin.
Yeah, right. I'm Patrick Cronin, even if you don't like my comment.
And in the middle...
It's the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, by the way, not industrial, which is a key point here. That this is not industry. This is infrastructure, very, very key. Mm-hmm.
Yes, you can say more about it. And then one in the middle is Dr. Thompson from Center for Naval Analysis. But you notice that we have one panelist missing. He couldn't come here because of family matters. And then now we have the second speaker, Dr. Thompson from the Center for Naval Analysis.
Great, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to say that I'm very pleased to be here today and to once again be working with the Army War College and Nate Fryer and Dr. Lai to co-sponsor this panel. And I think it's a great relationship that the Center for Naval Analysis has had with the Army War College and brings together some valuable insights and some synergies. Unlike my fellow panelists here, I am not an Asia-Pacific security specialist. My role at the Center for Naval Analysis, which is the Navy and Marine Corps' federally funded research and development center, is to oversee a broad portfolio of work that focuses on strategy and policy and mill-to-mill cooperation and the planning of campaigns and the assessment of campaigns. And much of my thinking about this region is shaped by interactions with senior military folks from the U.S. In the Pentagon, in Hawaii, in forward deployed commands, and in interacting with counterparts from partner militaries in this part of the world, and a series of track 1.5 dialogues where we work with think tanks associated with ministries of defense and services throughout the region to gain perspectives and have conversations that somewhere fall between formal government to government conversations and sort of, you know, second track, you know, think tank to think tank. So that's kind of interesting. So an interesting place to sit and gives me a perspective that is more steeped in the military relationships and the tools of the military cooperation than it is in deep expertise in the region. So I say that at the outset. I'm going to talk about what I consider to be one of the most interesting and salient aspects of our evolving mill-to-mill relationships in the Asia-Pacific region, and a region that the United States military leadership is increasingly referring to as the Indo-Asia-Pacific, to give a broader perspective and to think about how the countries of this long littoral relate to each other and relate to our interests. And I'm going to focus on military-to-military partnerships and the dynamics and atmospherics around those partnerships that create some of what I think are the most interesting dilemmas, or what I will refer to as impedance mismatches, between the way that we think about using the military toolkit and military-to-military cooperation and the way our partners do in what this conference is calling the new great game. So, you know, while there is great complexity and nuance and a diversity of U.S. priorities in the Asia-Pacific region, I think at the grand strategic level, you know, we are trying to protect and bolster international economic order that is bounded by rules and norms, that works very well and benefits the U.S. economy and those of our friends. That we're trying to ensure partnerships and alliances that endure and evolve over time in ways that enhance our own security, that increase the capability of our partners to generate and provide security for themselves and for the region in ways that bring us benefit as well, that we're obviously trying to influence the rise of China in ways that minimize the things that we find nefarious and disruptive of the international order that brings peace, stability, and prosperity the way we've known it for a long period of time and the way we aspire it to continue for quite some time to come, and accentuate those positive things that the Chinese do that are in kind and character with the norms of international behavior. We want to, as an end in and of itself, I think, advance and solidify the character and value of America's role as a Pacific power. And I think we want to promote collective approaches to the main security, economic, and political challenges of the region. And in the mill-to-mill realm, that means humanitarian assistance, disaster relief, and preparedness. And so when we take these sort of grand strategic ideals and priorities and stick them into the lane of the Department of Defense and the national security community, as we've talked about before, this is manifesting itself most powerfully and cogently in the rebalance. And I noticed as Secretary Carter spoke yesterday to Arizona State University students, he talked about the idea of the rebalance, and he said to the students, the thinking behind it, and he said, the rebalance is a long word. I'm not sure what that means, but he says, in thinking about it, it's a long word with a fairly short and straightforward precept behind it. After 10 years of war in Iraq and Afghanistan, the president has decided to restore strategic balance across our foreign, economic, and military affairs, to revitalize our engagement in the Asia-Pacific, and to ensure that we do not lose ground in this dynamic and important region. So how do we do that in the Department of Defense, and how does the military fit into that? Well, no surprise to anyone in this room, the primary means through which the Department of Defense exercises the military-to-military cooperation as a tool, as a means, in this broader rebalance to attain these objectives is through the United States Pacific Command, right? And PACOM's primary job is to defend the homeland, strengthen and modernize our alliances and partnerships, maintain access in areas of common interest, counter aggression, prevent proliferation of the weapons of mass destruction, and defeat violent extremism. That's sort of the mission statement of PACOM right now. So that gives us lots of opportunities to think about military-to-military cooperation as a set of tools that can be used to achieve these missions and accomplish the national objectives. And we'll do this by supporting and sustaining forward presence and posture of our troops, by demonstrating our commitment to our interests and our treaty obligations, expanding and deepening our ability to deter and counter aggression, rapidly respond to crises, and empower regional countries to contribute to their security. So when we get to working with other countries in the military environment, in this kind, there are really four general sort of tools in our toolkit. The toolkit is actually pretty diverse, but I think of it in four general terms. There's force posture, presence, and basing in the region, and the interactions that go to support and enable that. There's security cooperation and capacity building, working with other militaries to help them do what they do better. There is senior leadership engagement and dialogues and strategic communications, how we talk about what we're doing and how do we talk to people in the region. And then there are combined operations, when we actually bring our military forces together. So what that looks like when the United States puts on the scope of view of the rebalance, what we're doing when we're talking about interacting in the mil-to-mil level in areas of force presence and posture, it's about construction and investment in our ability to sustain and maintain appropriate and relevant forces in the region. That is, you know, investing in facilities in Iwakuni to move the U.S. air carrier wing from Matsugi. It's about a Futenma replacement facility to build new air bases that will better posture us in Okinawa. It's about signing the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement with the Philippines that allows us to pre-stage equipment there and rotationally deploy forces there under certain circumstances. It's about the investments that we're making in Darwin and Australia to enable a persistent rotational deployment of U.S. Marine Corps forces there. It's about hardening facilities in Guam and in Japan to allow us to maintain access and the ability to maneuver our forces in any sort of conflict scenario. It's about developing options to get access to airstrips in the Northern Marianas for divert airfields for increasing presence of U.S. military aircraft in the region. But it's also, when we think about force posture and presence, it's about what forces we put in the region, what kind and character they are, where they are, what they're doing, and that is reflected, as you well know, in the littoral combat ships to Singapore, increasing use of J-STARS and E-3s, AWACS in the Asia Pacific. It's about putting advanced radars for ballistic missile defense in Australia and in Japan. It's about putting more high-end equipment like F-22s and ballistic missile submarines in the Pacific. Other tools are exercises. You know, there are hundreds of exercises that go on every year in the PACOM AOR. There are big ones like RIMPAC, the Rim of the Pacific, which this past year included 22 nations, including the Chinese Navy as well. There are the CARAT exercises, which are rotational efforts to work with six different countries bilaterally to promote maritime security. There are bilateral, like Key Resolve with the U.S. Marine Corps and the ROC Marine Corps. One of the ones that I sort of discovered recently was something called Conquest, which is an exercise that we do in Mongolia with the Alaskan National Guard on earthquake preparedness. And so the diversity of high-end warfighting to low-end natural disaster response to using top of the line, F-22s, soon F-35s, and National Guard forces and reserves runs the spectrum of the exercises. The training you all well know, JSETs, mil-to-mil exchanges, opening U.S. schoolhouses, information sharing and intel sharing are components of this, transfer of technology and equipment. Of course, when we do that, we do this through the mind of what would be helpful to us. So a great example is the transfer of global hawk capabilities and technologies to the Republic of Korea and our BMD developments. Cooperative developments in BFD technology with the Japanese. Another tool is our senior leader engagement. There are hundreds of general officers and flag officers that visit countries in this part of the world every year to talk about and advance our security relationship. The SecDef goes regularly, went to five or six different countries in the last several months. The new Secretary of Defense, his first trip out of the country, is going to Asia. But despite our aspirations, these leaders say a lot of different things in a lot of different ways to a lot of different countries, sometimes publicly, sometimes privately, and sometimes it's hard to determine which they were intending to when they made these statements. And then there are a very limited number of combined military operations. It's usually HADR related, but there's also the Proliferation Security Initiative disrupting the flow of weapons of mass destruction. It's not the exercises make it to the front page, the operations often don't make it to the front page. And then there are counterterrorism operations and counterpiracy operations all the time. So when we, that's sort of on the US side, when we think about what we're trying to accomplish, when we think about our relationships, when we think about the DoD role, and we think about the tool of mil-to-mil engagement, that's what we think about its role as playing and its character and kind for us. So coming at this and looking at the perspectives of our partners, and again, I'm not an Asia-Pacific specialist, but having had a lot of opportunity to interact with partners in the region, hear their perspectives, have dialogues year after year after year with key leaders, I've sort of reached some judgments about what I think their strategic priorities are and how they think about the mill-to-mill tool as fitting into this. And I'll talk about this briefly, and then I'll map out for you what I think are sort of the impedance mismatches here. Right, so Japan is clearly dealing with what they see as a rising China with irredentist intents backed by a rapidly expanding military and complemented by non-military coercive capabilities. And they view the U.S. military relationship is critical, if not central, to the challenge that Japan is facing. At the same time, Japan is trying to expand and fund high-end warfighting capabilities to include missile defense, amphibious warfare, and a range of war-at-sea capabilities. All the while, the current Abe government is and the Japanese Diet are on what I would consider a journey of exploration into redefining the boundaries of what the Japanese self-defense forces can and should do, while wrestling with the total cost of ownership of this new expanded high-end military at a time when their economy remains sort of flatlined and the demographics are not working towards sustaining a large and expanding all-volunteer military. So that's my take on the Japanese perspective. The ASEAN countries, from my perspective, are individually evaluating the changing security environment and the military balance in the region, while collectively trying to promote collaborative and cooperative approaches to political, economic, and security dilemmas. And they are each reaching independent judgments about what paths will generate long-term security in ways that won't provoke China, but in which they will not have to cower in the face of a rising Beijing either. When it comes to Australia, I see Australia as having committed itself to essentially the deepest level of military cooperation it can have with the United States from its treaty alliance. It's a Five Eyes nation. It's embedded its officers in U.S. commands and U.S.-led coalition commands around the world. It gets involved in operations in far-flung places in partnership with us. And it's expanding the footprint it allows the United States to keep ashore in Australia. But at the same time, it's taking stock of the rise of China through a different frame of reference. Dr. Saunders just talked a little about that. And it also considers itself an indispensable military power in the region in its own right, with a special set of relationships with regional countries that it does not want to abandon or dilute. South Korea, for its part, I see is growing increasingly skeptical of North Korea's intentions and its capabilities, and it still remains convinced of the long-term benefits of peaceful reunification. But I see South Korea living with two competing impulses. The first is to be able to respond robustly, immediately, and potentially independently to North Korean provocation, while at the same time, the second tendency is to try to slow down and roll back steps to distance itself from the United States and make itself more independent. We've heard the conversations about delaying OPCON transfer for forces in Korea. So these two competing tendencies are both balled up with the military-to-military relationship. And finally, I'll mention India, which I think is trying to assert, and where possible demonstrate that it, like China, is a rising Asian power, and that its regional global influence is relevant and appropriate, and does not appear hollow when other people look at it, other countries look at it. And it's seeking partnerships that empower and enable its rise, including the expansion of its military capabilities through cooperation with others, while maintaining its assertively independent and non-aligned strategic posture. So, when I look at the strategic objectives of our regional powers, of regional partners, and how the mill-to-mill relationship with the United States fits into that, and then I look at what the U.S. is trying to do in the region, and look at how we think about and employ the military-to-military tools as a means to our national ends, I see some potential, what I call, impedance mismatches in the way that that we tend to conceptualize and apply the military-to-military toolkit and the ways our partners would like to pursue their own security. So as I wrap up my comments here in the next few minutes, I'll highlight some of these impedance mismatches on the premise that if we don't recognize and work around or avoid these impedance mismatches, we may find ourselves wondering why on earth our mill-to-mill tools don't seem to be as productive as we thought and would like them to be as we went about planning and trying to execute them. So the primary dilemmas and impedance mismatches that I see in these five relationships are with Japan, right? They want the U.S. military to be a partner with the Japanese self-defense forces to promote a robust and outward-facing deterrent posture, to expand JSDF capabilities, especially at the high end, and demonstrate the enduring relevance and value of the alliance. And that's all well and good. We like those things as well. But the potential impedance mismatch comes in the way we think about and talk about military posture and basing in the region, for example. When we talk about Japanese expenditures to fund some of these changes in military posture, when we talk about reconfiguring and hardening our posture in Okinawa, these are some of the most sensitive domestic political matters out there. And if we're not careful and we're not coordinated in the way we use key leader engagement and strategic communications and public statements, we might get ourselves in a situation where it's harder to work as closely with, harder than it should be to work as closely with the Japanese as we'd like. There also is a prevailing tendency in the United States to think that multilateral is better than bilateral when it comes to military cooperation. Well, in the Japanese case, this is a little tricky because not a lot of other countries in the region want to work with the Japanese military, want to invite them into their territorial waters or invite them into their countries. And we have to be cognizant of the fact that the Japanese are going through this journey of exploration, not exactly sure how they want to use the military forces outside the self-defense role, what those baby steps will be, in what areas they're more or less comfortable. And as we try to push them into things that already exist in our mind as reasonable and thoughtful ways of multilateralizing our bilateral other exercises and training events, we may create an impedance mismatch where there doesn't need to be one. When it comes to the ASEAN countries, right, for their own purposes, several ASEAN countries, including Singapore and the Philippines and Vietnam, have been quite forward-leaning in opening up themselves and their territories to greater military engagement and access. What we need to be mindful of, though, is that they are reaching judgments about the value and utility of these relationships and the access they're giving based on their own strategic paradigm. And I'm concerned that we will begin to bin countries in ASEAN in the ways we think about our treaty allies and partners and the expansiveness of the things that we want to do and that we use this basing and access in ways that are traditionally, you know, sensical to us, but maybe contrary to what they're trying to accomplish themselves. And as we think about and talk about multilateralism, ASEAN seems to be one of those multilateral organizations that actually works pretty well, does things, creates outcomes, and we want to glom onto these things and we want to press ourselves into it and we want to securitize these things as a functioning venue. And that's not the way that I perceive ASEAN countries think about ASEAN itself, so we have to guard our own tendencies. When it comes to Australia, I mean, there's clearly long-term strategic commitment by Australia to the military-to-military relationship with the United States. Where I see the potential impedance mismatch is, you know, Australia is a dynamic democratic country that is going through some political evolutions internally that we don't necessarily understand or track as a normal course of business in the mill-to-mill lanes within our own services and within our own joint force. And also, we're about to make a bunch of decisions that are going to be awkward for the Australians in terms of what we're trying to invest in terms of development for our basing in Darwin, in terms of what we're asking them to do, in terms of what we're asking them to agree to, in terms of what we're asking them to pay for, in terms of what we're going to ask to do or what we're going to do without asking with our forces that are based there. And that's going to create awkwardness. I don't think we should be mindful of that. We should not think that that is necessarily a fundamental breakdown in the relationship. It's new challenges that we're going to expose ourselves to. And if we don't think it through, we're going to look for signs of what you just said of, wait a minute, maybe the Australians are thinking about their future is with China and not with a security partnership with us. So we need to make sure that we don't create an impedance mismatch where there doesn't need to be one. With South Korea, you know, as I mentioned it, there clearly is a strong military-to-military relation. We just need to make sure that we are not frustrated by the fact that South Korea has these two tendencies of wanting to be able to work effectively and independently, yet still wanting to rely on us at the same time. And they'll say different things at different moments, in different moments of crises and different times of their political cycle. And we need not to get wrapped up in that. And finally, when it comes to India, you know, the emergence of an India that is stable, democratic, economically integrated into the world, a supporter of international norms and rules, an exporter of security capabilities and capacity building, someone who responds to, you know, international crises and is a partner with the United States, is a great thing for us. For India, you know, a military-to-military partnership with the United States that allows them to get access to technology and training. These are all good things. Where I think the potential impedance mismatch is here is when expectations in time and scale get out of sync between the United States and India. And I've been watching this for the last several years. The signing of the strategic partnership meant Indian expectations about what they were going to get out of the military-to-military relationship went through the roof, and they thought they were going to get carrier, you know, technology and EMALs, and they were going to get, you know, nuclear submarines. We're going to lease them to them and give them the plans. That's just that thinking has changed. Reality is setting on the Indian minds, and they understand that not all these things are possible. But there were two or three or four years where there was real intense frustration in the mill-to-mill relationship because the expectations mismatched. And the other part of it is, right, both of these militaries and democratic systems are beholden to political leaders, bureaucratic systems, you know, the civilian leadership's interagency processes. And, you know, you think we have problems coordinating the interagency on our side. Go try to get an Indian military leader, commander, to get his interagency to do anything. And, you know, you're already leading yourselves to a moment where you're going to think things are impossible. They're not impossible in the Indian timescale and process. It's just the way we think about planning and execution doesn't line up well internally in the military for our interagency, doesn't work very well on the Indian side. When you bring those two together, it makes more of a potential impedance mismatch. So in wrapping up, I'd just like to say that while the mill-to-mill tool is one of the most prominent and frequently exercised means of U.S. foreign policy in the Indo-Asia-Pacific and provides the U.S. cards to play in the great game, the logic and value of the employment of this tool doesn't always appear to our partners the same way as it appears to us.
Well, thank you. We now turn to Dr. Cronin for his thoughts. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, David, thank you very much. A delight to be back at the Army War College and to see my old boss, Bob Work, especially now as the Deputy Secretary of Defense, giving everybody here, including us, the challenge to think strategically. Not that budgets don't matter, as I think was misrepresented on the morning panel, but rather that thinking is underutilized and really needed. Bob used to challenge us every day coming to work at the Center for New American Security. Now we get those challenges from Michelle Flournoy and Richard Fontaine and Kurt Campbell, and they're equally challenging. But these are strategic issues. And this panel, let me do stick to the topic of the panel here. We were given the topic of the new great game. So let me keep this more at the strategic level. There's been great comments made, and we've covered a lot of ground. Phil Saunders and Eric Thompson have covered a lot of ground on these issues. But let me just make five broad points. The first is that, of course, it's not really a new great game. an obvious point, this is ancient. We even heard, and Phil alluded to the fact that there's been something called the Middle Kingdom in the past, and tribute is something that China came to expect from a lot of its neighbors, and that's what a lot of its neighbors worry, that they may want to go back to that style of relationship, the kind of relationship that Singaporeans and others heard at a foreign minister's dialogue in 2010, when the Chinese foreign minister said, you know, we're a great power, you're not, and that's a fact. It's that kind of attitude that creates anxiety among the periphery, as China refers to its diplomacy on its borders in its near seas. So it's not entirely new. This is very much an old game, and Dr. Saunders also, I think, rightly pointed out one of the nice recent illustrations, the pressure on Korea to forego the theater high altitude area defense system, very subtle, but it was made very clear to me by a former Korean top-level official just last week that if the Chinese assumption of closer economic ties with China is essentially the Finlandization of Korea's policy, foreign defense policy, that's not sustainable. That's not on. But watch this space. It's a moving target. This is all a balancing game. This is why we need to get away from Clausewitz and more to Sun Tzu, right? And if I give you one bit of advice here today, it is to read Derek Yuen's book, wonderful new book, on deciphering Sun Tzu's The Art of War, a wonderful book that explains better than I can explain today in 10 minutes or 15 minutes why there's a yin and yang, why these are contradictions that have to coexist. And what China's doing is not just one or the other. It's using both back and forth until the two sides of the military and the non-military become almost formless and shapeless and always moving to where it can gain the most opportunity. And if the United States and its allies and partners take a very rigid position, we'll fall right into that trap. That's why it is more like the game of Go than it is chess, but there's a lot to be learned from chess as well. And I have no doubt that Chinese computer experts will eventually create a computer to defeat the game of Go. But China's future, in terms of not being new, you know, China's future, let me just talk about this linearity. When you go to Asia-Pacific these days, it's hard not in scene setting on the strategy and the current security environment for someone to say the big picture is this power transition. China's rising, America's declining, and we've heard it over and over and over again. And at some point, you get tired of hearing this, but also you start to really question whether it's true, or to what extent is it true, or how is it true and how is it not true? So we've seen China rise, we've seen China possibly slow down, the rate of growth is slowing, how much will it slow, how much will U.S. relative decline continue to decline, and will things like the shale gas revolution, I had John Deutsch on a panel in New York last week, great discussion how this has bought the United States, North America really, 30, 40 years of potential enormous economic boost in terms of the shale gas revolution. That's technology that we have an advantage on in North America. We can actually help the Chinese on this technology. They need it in the future. There are opportunities here. So anyway, it's not new. And the future is not foreordained. It's not David Shambaugh in his op-ed very famously recently writing about how the party's over and there could be collapse of the Communist Party. Maybe right. Michael Pillsbury in his best-selling book says China's been marching on a 100-year-long strategy. Has to be watched very closely. Well, he has a lot of information in that book. It's a very, very interesting argument. But nobody knows the future of China, and nobody knows the future of the United States. And it's that uncertainty and volatility that we have to live in, which is why balanced force, balanced strategy, hedging, you bet. All of those things are going to be hallmarks of what we're going to have to be doing across the government and in the private sector. Second point is the big challenge for the United States and allies and partners is to rethink strategy. It was Bob Work's, I think, main point this morning, but I would go even further than Bob in terms of thinking about long-term competition. So I get very worried when I see friends in the Pentagon, you know, giving me escalation ladders, because the escalation ladder is both very helpful in thinking about how conflict could rise very quickly. It's a very important issue, so I'm not trivializing it, but it also can be very misleading, because what we're really talking about here, and Phil Saunders was essentially alluding to this, that you know, when he said countries don't want to make a choice, that's because we're in these gray zone areas, whether you like the word gray zone or not. We're in an area where there's competition. We're in a very strong competition. That is indeed the great game. Okay, we are in a strong competition that does not necessarily have to escalate. Or if it escalates, the escalation can be very limited. Now, that doesn't mean it could not also escalate to very dangerous levels, but I can start to tell you about the scenarios that could lead to that. For instance, over Taiwan, where you have a core interest of China. That's very different from the reclamation of artificial islands in the South China Sea, even though that's becoming an increasingly important interest. Again, as Dr. Saunders pointed out, that China wants to try to find ways to gain these historical claims and build that influence even while it continues its development. But continuing the development is the key. So it's going to oscillate between these two sort of trajectories of increasing influence in the neighborhood all around the border and trying to develop. And because of that, if you put pressure and impose costs and denial strategies and offset strategies on China, and you take a little bit of risk, you can push back on China. And they'll go toward the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and find open ground there. And when the United States doesn't have any offensive tool on the development and trade front, other than Trans-Pacific Partnership, China will find some perception gains and soft power. That's what's basically been happening over the last couple of months. Anyway, so we need to rethink our strategy about both imposing costs on these gray zone challenges that China's posing, but also on thinking about our holistic strategy, our comprehensive strategy, that we can go back and forth with all the instruments of power. Dr. Saunders had exactly the right message in terms of thinking about its trade and diplomacy. He's absolutely right. The problem is that he sits in the Department of Defense. You know, I'm outside, actually, and I'm telling you that we need to go beyond the Department of Defense. Department of Defense, for all of its challenges, works brilliantly compared to the other instruments, our policy. One of the reasons I was so happy to see at least the Iran negotiation deal get this far is simply to showcase that diplomacy can be used for strategic purpose. You don't have to like the deal. We don't even know what the deal is in terms of its final output. but just the fact that diplomacy and statecraft can actually be an American tradecraft again is a good thing. It's a good thing for the military. It's a good thing. That's why Secretaries Gates and Panetta used to talk about the need to build the relationship between diplomacy and defense, in part. I'm digressing here, but in addition to rethinking our strategy, the gray zone situation, I've written a report, and we've done a number of studies recently, you can see on the Center for a New American Security website, on cost-imposing strategies. This is especially on maritime Asia in the East and South China Seas. There are things that can be done. Most of what can be done in terms of imposing costs, though, are not military directly, at least. They're more indirect. So it's imposing reputational costs, for instance, by putting out declassified overhead satellite imagery, which is exactly, if you've seen any website in the last month, you'll see some spectacular photography of the 7 artificial islands that China's building in the South China Sea. It's wonderful photography. It's also very useful to mobilize the region around what's happening and to make people aware that this encroachment may come at the expense of the region, especially when you go back in even recent history and think about Mischief Reef, which the Chinese at the time claimed was going to be useful for regional fishing, even for the Philippines, and then became a Chinese PLA military outpost. We need to deny and offset the gains that China makes as well. On the cost imposition, there are also legal measures. Those legal measures, for instance, what the Philippines are doing before the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea, trying to demonstrate that the Chinese claim to this vague 9-line claim of the South China Sea has no basis in contemporary international law. That could be very useful. We need to support that and find other ways to support that. The issue of where what military passage is allowed inside the exclusive economic zones is a key issue for the United States to reassure and deter in the region. And if the Chinese have their interpretation of international law accepted, we would need to have permission to have any kind of military operation, including for surveillance, outside of the territorial air limit of 12 nautical miles, but within the 200 nautical mile limit. And we reserve the right to say that, no, actually listening and watching is not a threat. It's actually a public good for the region. It's necessary for deterrence. And as China builds up a ballistic missile submarine fleet off of Hainan, it's going to be more important, because that's one of the reasons they're building these reclamation projects, by the way. They're springboards for power projection and influence. They're new facts on new ground, if you will. But they are also trying to build a sanctuary for the ballistic missile submarines, as well as to essentially deny the United States any ability to resupply Taiwan in a crisis. And ultimately, that may be the main first aim, because they want to deny that possibility. We need to deny and offset the gains of these gray zone situations where there's tailored coercion by China. We can build capacity, and two types of capacity I've talked about in recent reports. One of them is building maritime domain awareness, even creating a common operating picture. So this really gets into the command and control, the intelligence surveillance reconnaissance systems that will, with allies like Australia and Japan, be at a very high level. With new partners, it may be at a much lower level where it could be shared regionally as humanitarian assistance, disaster relief kind of information across the board, public good for the Chinese as well, but allows greater transparency so that there's, again, an easier way to impose reputational costs if there's unilateral assertiveness, it gets out of hands, or fortification. We can also build up the anti-access and area denial capability. So Taiwan getting F-16s doesn't necessarily really help with anti-access error denial. Having some kind of undersea capability, any type, not necessarily sophisticated submarines, would be a very strong way to be a deterrent to an easier Chinese invasion, which could be threatened coercively by the mainland, for instance. Engagement with China, of course, is still a critical part of that. The United States has been stepping up its engagement, even while it's frozen some of the extended engagement, military to military, right now with China. There's no shortage of dialogue with the Chinese. My concern with my Chinese friends, and I can tell you both from the government and non-government that I've met with in the last year alone, have said some of the most alarming things. And I dare repeat them in public, but I mean, one of them, most recently, just last week, was essentially that United States has to accommodate China. Well, we have accommodated China. We continue to accommodate China. We accommodate a rising China. But we do not accommodate or excuse bad behavior and coercive behavior. And there's a difference there. But basically, the Chinese said, well, it's all or nothing. Well, it really isn't all or nothing. That's just their talking point. That's their information line. That's their propaganda line. And they apply it very well, but they don't really mean it. It's not really even a core interest on the part of the Chinese. And that's where we have to press back and be a little more assertive on our own information, working with allies and partners. But they've said other things that are more concerning, including things like Japan will never be allowed to have to be a major security player in Northeast Asia, military player. Now, this is just one person's view, but it was concerning. I think Phil was there at that meeting. It certainly caught my attention that this is partly pressure on America to put pressure on our key ally, to put pressure on Abe not to go too far with redefining collective self-defense and the self-defense forces. Sure, we get that. But at the same time, they may start to believe that, just that they may believe the South China Sea is really a core interest rather than just a very important interest. Well, those are some of the points I wanted to make, and I know we were already running late when I started talking, David, but the key point I wanted to make was essentially this need for a much more comprehensive strategic way of thinking about the Chinese competition. Rather than jumping to a military scenario of escalation, again, there's a place for that. It's very important. There are a lot of defense implications of what I'm saying here in terms of the balance force. I can talk about that in terms of both building partnership capacity, our critical presence. Eric hit on a lot of issues that related to our critical presence and how we disperse that presence and how we make sure that our presence is the backbone, the insurance, so that we can do the trade and diplomacy that Phil Saunders was talking about in the first place. And Trans-Pacific Partnership is indeed vital for that. I wrote an op-ed recently in the Singapore Straits Times on why this is really the key national security initiative of the United States. And we have to make sure that we are trading and investing with the region of the world that will account for most of the middle class in the world, especially all the new middle class that's going to grow up in the next 20 years. This is where the 21st century will be determined. We have to play this great game in Asia, but it's not mostly a military game. It's a comprehensive strategic challenge, and indeed, it is more like the game of Go than chess. So thank you.
Well, thank you. I'm already see some very eager spring butts here waiting to ask questions. And also, I'd like to report that we really keep the audience engaged, especially by the talks. And then, so I think they have touched upon some very touchy issues in the Asia Pacific. So please have your questions and challenge our panelists, and then share more of their thoughts on these issues. Yes.
Good afternoon, Colonel Jason Curtis, student this year. A question is, we talked strategy, and at the very beginning of the presentation, there was a governing assumption, we've defeated communism at the end of the Cold War. Well, obviously, China is still a communist nation. Our defense strategy, our national security strategy, talks about promotion of democracy is fundamental to our national security. So for any of the panel members, this ideological basis, which has not been mentioned throughout the day so far, of our promoting democracy, how does that play vis-a-vis China and the partners that are in competition right now?
Thank you. You want to answer to that?
Jumping briefly on a very complex, important issue. Didn't mention it. It was in my notes. The competition for an inclusive rules-based system that is congruent with U.S. interests and values very much subsumes democracy and human rights. I've described the interest based in a much more realpolitik sense of the great game, partly for time. But that's what we are working for. We are actually working in this competition for the kind of system that is congruent with our values. We would like to see that expand, but we have to do it realistically. And we have to understand that even partners like Vietnam, and I met with the Vietnamese ambassador yesterday at Vietnam House in Washington, had lunch with him, is a communist. And yet, he's a very useful communist right now for the United States interests. not only because Vietnamese want to join the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and frankly, that's the key to bringing about political reform. We're trying to bring about political reform in the long run in Myanmar as well, in Burma. There are a lot of places where we need to engage and try to work. And the Chinese are communists in name. It's really, it's called a monopoly of power more than communist ideology, though. And it's much more historically rooted, I think. So communism as a label doesn't help me very much in terms of thinking of strategy. But what do we stand for? What do we want to see built around this world? Yes, that's where we need strategic offense. It's a very broad strategic offense. We want to project our values, but we need to do it in a way that's humble, reflecting our own problems and challenges, but because we believe in individual liberty. We believe in freedom. And the most important thing, and here's what the Vietnamese ambassador told me, and this was not off the record, is the most important thing to the Vietnamese in terms of China, besides they have to survive, is their independence. They have to get along with China. Phil Saunders is absolutely right. But not just the Vietnamese, but everybody in the region, they want independence. That's an opening for the United States to say, yes, making the world safe for diversity, I think, was one of Paul Nitze's last bumper stickers before he passed away. I think he had a lot of wisdom in that.
If I could just add to that, I mean, I agree with Patrick that it's still the Chinese Communist Party, but there's not really an ideology there that can be exported to other countries. So it's a different kind of situation than it was during the Cold War when there really was an ideological threat. You know, instead what we see is kind of a making common cause with other governments that are authoritarian, or whether that's Russia, whether that's others in the world, and making common cause on that in ways that rolls back in some ways some of the liberal democratic values that are embedded in the international system. But we shouldn't apologize for being a democracy. That's an asset, and it's something a lot of countries in the world and their populations, even if their governments, don't find a very appealing aspect of the United States, and it is a strategic asset. And I would argue that China's own authoritarian system, especially as it is cracking down over the last year, that's not a pretty picture. That's not an asset around the world. You don't see countries, you don't see people in countries saying, we need a leadership like that that's closing off the internet, that's suppressing civil society, that's afraid of female activists. You know, that's, to my view, it's a strategic liability for China.
Any more questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Jessie Babcock. I'm from the Office of the Secretary of Defense and Policy specifically. And I'm interested in how you view the impact of the potential vulnerabilities of the PLA on the long-term competition going forward. There was a great RAND report that came out recently about the PLA's vulnerabilities. You probably read it, talking a lot about rampant corruption and lack of combat capabilities. How does this influence our thinking about the security competition?
Well, it's a challenge to assess. I thought the RAND report did a nice job of pointing out a lot of the weaknesses and the other sides. My day job, I run the China Center at National Defense University. You know, and that's the challenge we have, is really assessing the capabilities of a military that hasn't engaged in serious combat since 1979 and didn't do that well back then, but that has been making very real efforts to improve the quality of their equipment, to improve their training, to improve their personnel, and trying to understand what all of that adds up to. Is a difficult analytic challenge. So we watch their training and we try to come up with the best sense we can of it. I think a part to recognize is that China has become somewhat more transparent, but in sending the messages that they want to send and trying to control that message, and has shifted from downplaying capability to perhaps exaggerating capability a little bit. And you'll see some of that when they do their big military parade that they're planning for. But I think it's important to both see the technological advances they're making, consider them and how to respond to them, but also recognizing that there are gaps, there are shortcomings, there's a lack of combat experience, and their ability to really fight and wage a joint campaign effectively, to my mind, is a big question mark. It's something they're trying hard to develop the capability, but still have a long way to go. So that's not exactly an answer of how to exploit it, but it's more a mindset of taking an objective look at where they're gaining ground and balancing that against the weaknesses, and then the challenge for strategy is how do you exploit those.
A good answer, and I'm just building on that. Again, since I'm emphasizing today classical Chinese strategic thought and how the weak defeat the strong, I mean, there are incredible ideas for how China does this beyond through deception. One, first of all, takes great note of the rapid strides they've made. So for all the problems that are pointed out in the RAND study and other studies, it's incredible what they've done. How have they become this maritime power? So great Singapore diplomat Bilahari Kausikan gave remarks this past week on a book that was just launched about China's Belt and Road strategy, the Silk Road and the Maritime Belt. He disagreed with the author's thesis that China would succeed moving across Eurasia in the Maritime Silk Road, but not really ever become a global major naval power. He said it's just the opposite. He said China's more likely to falter on the treacherous sands of Central Asia, which sounds plausible to me, but it's more likely to eventually succeed, providing, fill in the assumptions about China's growth and commitment, but it's more likely to be succeeding there if you think out the next couple of decades. So what's our timeline? Are we thinking about 2015? If so, its presence and its perception, and that's why we can push back. But the Chinese are trying to cash in on that already by saying, well, think, America, where are you going to be in 2025? And where are the frontline states around China's periphery going to be in 2025 or 2030? More economically dependent, look at Korea. And we do have greater local advantage than we had back in 2015. They're playing that game without trying to overinvest. And as Deputy Secretary Work pointed out, you know, we're on the wrong side of the cost imposition as well. We're building the multi-billion-dollar platforms, and they're building the million-dollar missiles. Which one has the advantage? So we have to figure out cost-effective ways to build up anti-access area denial capabilities for our allies and partners without militarizing places like the South China Sea, which are not mostly military zones. That's a real challenge for us. If China can box us in from the moves that we have to make, they've effectively neutralized a superior force. It's what Soleimani has done in the greater Middle East, the Iranian, by boxing us in and preventing us from being able to intervene in various places in the Middle East. Sorry to go to another region, but the point is this is a strategy of boxing in the superior power. And right now, China's able to do this pretty well, but not well enough because the region sees through most of China's games. They want democracy. They want at least American protection. And they want America there as a balancing counterweight, provided we don't create a war.
I think in looking at long-term competitive strategies in the large, there are also a couple of things to also worthwhile to keep in mind. One is it's a lot easier to do that if you have a clear and shared across the government sense of what the threat is that you're trying to overcome. And that's a little difficult for us right now. And then in a globalized world, it becomes more difficult because there's a lot more information out there. There's a lot of other components that would need to be brought to bear, and people's perspectives are more diverse. So when we're talking about our friends and partners in the region and their complex relationships, it makes that threat assessment and that common view of what the threat is and how you would apply the tools and what's your advantage collectively makes it more more difficult. And also the times where we've been more successful, you need to have a bit of a long stare to understand what is the decision-making environment? What is their decisional culture? What are their institutional biases? And although we're spending a lot of time looking at China right now, I'm not sure that we're keeping up with the pace of change within China and developing that collective sense. And so we may struggle with this long-term competitive strategy approach with those two factors being such as they are.
If I could just add one more thing. I mean, I just want to underscore Eric Thompson's ran through a number of countries in the region. We can be obsessed with great powers. The Chinese would love for us to be obsessed with the great power game. But the world is not being run by the great powers these days, if you haven't noticed lately. And powers like India and Indonesia, where do they fall? They're pretty great in my regard. In fact, Japan's pretty great too, and yet China doesn't always consider Japan to be a great power. So there are a lot of great powers running around by that definition, and they're not necessarily just the ones we're talking about.
We have in the audience a very special guest. She's the daughter of Colonel Ziegler, and she has just returned from China after spending more than a year over there living and working. More importantly, she took a copy of our Army War College Quarterly last night and did some homework and reading my article. And she wants to challenge me and as well as our panelists. Let's give her a chance.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you guys. Really interesting stuff this afternoon. I've learned a lot. This question is for Dr. Lai. 就想问你,围棋是特别中国的东西,特别中国的游戏,你为什么用日本的名字呢? For those of you that don't speak Mandarin, I asked him, 围棋, Go, the game, is very Chinese game, very Chinese stuff. Why did he use the Japanese name for it? Also a follow-up question for the rest of the panel. Dr. Lai mentions that toward the end of his article that Wei Qi is a sort of win-win situation kind of game. It's a non-zero-sum game. How should we here in America, here at the Army War College, approach this game? How does it affect us, and how does that affect our strategy for China moving forward?
Well, thank you very much. The reason it used Japanese term is this. Japan took this game from China about 1,700 years ago during China's high time, and then turned it into Japan's national game. And Korea as well, about that time as well, also a Korean a national game. And then China suffered dynastic rise and fall. When China fell apart, the cultural things went away. Japan, however, is much more stable. And then in contemporary times, Japan is the first one that successfully embarked on industrialization and modernization and became the first Asian power to be accepted by the Western great powers to be a formidable one in Asia. And then they learn about this game from Japan, while China suffered from its internal problems and the game went down to the drain. So the game was invented by the Chinese, and it went to Japan, and then the West learned about it from Japan, and they thought it's a Japanese game. And a lot of the terminologies are in Japanese terms as well as a result. So now, currently, the Koreans, South Koreans, are sitting at the top. They are the champions. They have already taken over from Japan, and China is making a comeback. And now, thanks to the information revolution, the game is now making its way in all corners of the world. so we might as well just learn about it. So that short answer to that. Give you a chance to answer her question, the second one.
On the non-zero-sum nature of this. Now, there's a complicated thing. In international relations, we sometimes think about this in terms of relative gains, who gains more from a particular thing. But that's not really thinking about third parties. That's what complicates this. And this is, you know, maybe a different way to think about the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, is if China was doing this all bilaterally with particular countries, it would be in a stronger position to dictate the terms and try to maximize its advantage. And I think one of the reasons they're trying to set this up as a multilateral organization, albeit one where China will still have the dominant voice, in fact, it's to try to reassure countries a little bit that more of the gains will be shared and that there will be some degree of restraint on what China can do in this forum. And that's a way of kind of spreading the gains from this rather than looking at it as a purely zero-sum bilateral thing. What am I going to get out of it? To broaden it a little bit so there are multiple beneficiaries of it. And, you know, and to be honest, if that's how China is using its power by investing in infrastructure in Asia, I find that it does pose challenges for the United States because we have not been in that business in a big way in quite a while. But I'd rather have them doing that than investing that money in the PLA. And I think that's going to be part of the, you know, one of the consequences of the kind of the way I laid things out with the U.S. and China in competition over third countries is for the third countries, you try to hold both sides up and maximize what you can get from both of them. So I think your question is a pretty profound one. It's not entirely a zero-sum game. Infrastructure in Asia isn't necessarily a bad thing for the United States, but it's more complicated to think through the net assessment of it. And I don't think it's a good thing to be reflexively against anything just because China is doing it. We have to think a little more deeply, why is it attractive to countries in the region? And maybe we don't want to be in the way of that, but maybe we want to do something else instead, which benefits us and benefits others in the region, and even benefits China. So we have to think not necessarily symmetrically or in terms of blocking everything that China does. We may want to think, where are our strengths? Because that's one other final point to make on this economically. This kind of thing's easy for China to do. It's partly because they have manipulated their currency and have a trade surplus. That's generating a lot of US dollar revenues. If they bring it back, it creates inflation and other economic problems. So they need to keep that money overseas, and putting it in an infrastructure investment bank's a better deal than putting it in US treasuries, which are not paying as much as we might like right now. So that's something that's easy for them to do. There's other things that are a lot harder for them to do. They can't make the kind of security commitments that we do with our alliances. That's just not in their strategic DNA. And if they did make those commitments, nobody would believe them. So we have to think a little bit more about what are our core strengths as opposed to China's as well.
Good. I take that as your closing remark. And I'd like to keep the two of you briefly your closing thoughts too as well. We are running out of time a little bit. Okay.
Well, I think the message I would take away is, you know, the purpose of this panel is to talk about grand strategy, to bring in perspectives that go well beyond the military. It's a largely military audience here. You're going to be facing, you know, the opportunity to think and write in the war college environment, but when you get into other jobs, it's going to be about planning, it's going to be about, you know, building the PowerPoint slides, it's about, you know, writing the talking points for the DB visits, it's about, you know, figuring out the posture, basing laydown issues, the logistics, where you're going to do these. It is, I think, critically important to step back and take the 30,000-foot view and understand that there are, a bunch of other folks around the U.S. military trying to do the same sorts of things, and do we understand that? Do we wrap that together? Do we do it in a strategic sense? Do we communicate it? Do we prepare our leaders to think about and understand where they fit into this multifarious environment, and when they interact with our partners, that they're doing the same sort of thing with a different set of assumptions? And so how do you align those and how do you get the synergies is something that I would suggest that you focus on when you leave this room, and I hope I took some of that away from these guys, and I hope you did as well.
Thank you. Yeah, Patrick?
Well, maybe because the question was asked as well. I mean, I don't think win-win should mean China wins twice.
No. And
sometimes it's a self-inflicted wound, and I think the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank was exactly that. The United States, without its own initiative, basically put pressure on our allies, our closest friends around the world, and said, don't join that bank. They're going to give money for badly needed infrastructure, and there's a shortage of capital, but we have no idea of what to do ourselves. That was a lose-lose for the United States. And so the right answer, in part, was what Phil Saunders said, which was that we certainly should not be impeding this. This is a good thing in general. It's better than some of the alternatives. But I still want I want the strategic offense, and strategic here in the very comprehensive sense. So we have to think, if we're going to think at least like Basil Littlehart, if not like Sun Tzu, we've got to think about trying to set the conditions. The conditions of the great game, the competition, not just the ends and means. We're too reductionist. We've got to think broader about what we're trying to achieve here across the comprehensive power. And ultimately, because it comes back to values and democracy and human rights. Because, you know, when China effectively blocks the internet and the television from showing what kind of pollution actually exists in Russia, I mean, in China, that, you know, that's not the world we want to live in. So we do want to set rules with China. We want to work with China. We want to cooperate with China. We're cooperating all over the place with China. But there's a competition as well. And it's not all zero sum, and it's not all win-win. And there are third parties involved who could be hurt. And those third parties are largely the frontline states right now. And China looks at them and says, well, they're smaller powers. They don't matter. Let's deal with this at the G2 level, great powers. And then if we don't get our way with America, we don't join the major power, new type of major power relationship, they turn toward periphery diplomacy, and they turn toward infrastructure and soft power. And they win there. So we need to follow suit, not just by joining the AIB as well, but also putting some teeth into the Bretton Woods infrastructure that we helped create after the war, including the Asian Development Bank, including some new initiatives. I'm working on a new piece right now for Foreign Affairs with a co-author. I was the number 3 official at USAID. We have so much capability in this country and with our allies and partners on education, on healthcare, on energy technology, and we are not using them. This is a failure of strategic imagination inside the United States. So what do you do about it here at the Army War College? Imagine strategy.
Thank you, Patrick, for putting all these serious, important issues in such an entertaining way. I don't know if the useful communism or the China win-win twice are spontaneous or well-thought-of ideas, probably the latter. Thank you very much. Yeah, well done. And let's give our panelists a great round of applause.